Good morning and welcome to worship this morning at Faith Christian Reformed Church. This morning we are excited to welcome Jeremy Osterhaus to lead us. Jeremy is currently teaching Bible at Chicago Christian High School. So thank you, Jeremy.
Well, good morning, brothers and sisters. It is good to be here with you today, and let me start by sending greetings to you from the brothers and sisters at Chicago Christian High School, along with Emmanuel Christian Reformed Church, where we worship, and so I have the privilege of being there most weeks, not to preach, but to be part of their worshiping community, too. Why don't we rise today and receive God's the greeting for us. People of God, our Father welcomes us. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, who is our seal for eternity. Amen. As God greets us, let us turn and extend a hand of fellowship to each other too. So you guys are well trained. Some churches, it takes a bit more wrangling to get them back together again. People of God, our help is in the name of the Lord. And today, our call to worship for us comes from Psalm 28, verse 6 through 9. Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy. With my song, I praise him. The Lord is the strength of his people, a fortress of salvation for his anointed one. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Be their shepherd and carry them forever. Amen.
Praise him for he is your God and salvation.
When we gather to praise God, we remember that we are a people who have preferred our wills to His. Accepting His power to become new persons in Christ, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Let us pray together. There are many times we think we love you well, O God. But upon hearing your call to love you with all our heart, with all our mind, and all our strength, we confess that our love for you is a diluted love, made insipid and flat by lesser loyalties and a divided heart. Our love seems pure only for brief moments. Soon our affections are drawn away. How easily our devotion dies. Forgive us in deep mercy, spare us, despite our lost first love for you. In grace, rekindle our love for you in seeing Jesus anew and seeing His love for us. Amen. We find our assurance this morning from Ephesians 1, verses 3 through 6. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. Even before He made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in His eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into His own family by bringing us to Himself through Jesus Christ. This is what He wanted to do, and it gave Him great pleasure. So we praise God for the glorious grace He has poured out on us who belong to His Son, Jesus Christ. And let us sing a song of response, How Vast the Benefits Divine. We'd like to invite the children up for a children's message, and Miss Carol is going to lead that for us this morning.
Several kids here. So we have a book, and we're going to look at this book, okay? If you want to come up here with me. This story today is about gorilla families. You see the pictures? Okay. It says gorillas are the largest members of the ape family. They live in the mountains and lowlands of Africa. Although there are movies and stories about fierce giant gorillas, most gorillas live quiet and peaceful lives in small family groups. Both father and mother gorillas help care for their children. They are patient teachers and spend many hours playing games with their babies. When little gorillas are tired or frightened, their parents will pick them up and hug them or carry them on their backs. Mother gorillas teach their children how to build sleeping nests and how to find good things to eat. Young gorillas enjoy climbing and wrestling just like human children. God has placed people in families too. People in families protect and love one another, just like the gorillas. We can learn many things in our families. We learn to work and play together, to respect one another, and to do our part to help the family. God says that he is like a father to all his children. In a very special way, everyone who loves God belongs to his family, and it pleases God when we all love our brothers and sisters. And then there's a Bible verse. Whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially to our Christian brothers and sisters. And that's from Galatians 6, verse 10. And then just for you up here, how many babies do you see in the picture? That's right, two. And how many are in your family? Three. Okay. That's what we all learn, and we learn to love each other, right? So let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us families, for teaching us to love each other and to do things together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may go back to your seats.
Before we take up our scripture reading today, probably it's also appropriate to introduce my family to you as well. I know you sit in the back and you look at them. Who are those kids over there? We have Leah. She's 11. She'll be in sixth grade at Oak Lawn Campus this coming fall. And Asher is 9, almost 10. He'll be in fourth grade at Oak Lawn this coming fall too. And Rachel, my wife, is out with Dylan, our newborn, and so praise God for the gift of him this summer. He's born June 16. He's just 6 weeks old now, too. And if you remember us, say a prayer for us in the evening hours, midnight, night hours, as we are up with him quite often, such as it is for us. Maybe you guys laugh and remember those days yourself, too, what those are like, of course. Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verse 3 through 14. And before we take that up, I'd like to offer a prayer for reading the word today and our hearing of it too. Please pray with me. Father God, I thank you for the word you've given to us, and I thank you for the message I'll bring today too, Lord. And I ask that you would be present in this place. Send your spirit to be in our midst, to open our eyes and our ears and our hearts, Father, that we may hear your word for us today too. Lord God, we ask you to be with us in all things, in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you guys stand for the reading or do you sit for the reading? Sit, that's okay with me too. Either one is fine. The word of the Lord from the book of Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3 through 14. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will. And this is to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. Thanks be to God for his word, and thanks for the message we have herein today, too. Now, I do want to begin by pointing out one thing for this text here. If you look at this text in English, it's probably, I didn't even count today, 7 or 8 sentences there. Do you know in Greek it is just one? One sentence in Greek. Paul writes one magnificent sentence there. And of course, I imagine the translators looking at this say, how do we make sense of this 200 words? It seems like it's crazy for one sentence, and yet it is. And I want to point out for the purpose of today that the one sentence here in Greek is because all of this is about one thing only today, God's plan for us, God's plan for his people, to know him and to be one with him too. Now, if you look at this text today, I want to back up to just a few weeks ago, Friday, June 23. You see, that evening, the third-seeded Red Sox were playing the first-seeded Padres for the Mustang PBO Baseball Championship. The Padres were the better team, of course. They were the first seed, but the Mustangs were in a hot streak. They had won a few games in a row. I'm sorry, the Red Sox were on a winning streak. Red Sox were Asher's team. They had a plan to win. And their plan was this: play good defense, pitch well for the first 4 innings, just get to the last 2 innings when their closer would come in. Donnie was a good pitcher, hadn't allowed many runs the whole year. That was the plan: get to the point where Donnie could pitch, and then they could potentially win. But it was hot that day, 94 degrees. Donnie had been playing outside all afternoon, and he got up to bat, and he couldn't hit anymore. Heat stroke, or sickness, whatever it was. He was out for the game. So what was Coach Dave going to do? His best pitcher was out. The plan he had gone awry. Top of the 6th inning, the Red Sox are down 4-3, 2 runners on base. Sean comes up. Sean gets a walk. Base is loaded. Still down 4-3, 2 outs. Asher comes up. He walks too. Tie run comes in. And Owen comes up. Base is clearing, triple to right field, 3 runs come in. It's now 7-4. The Red Sox are ahead, but the bottom of the 6th is here. They need somebody to close the game out, and Donnie isn't there. They called Brady to pitch. Brady has pitched maybe a couple games the whole year. He's a good pitcher, but he's only pitched a couple times. Strikeout, walk, ground out again. The Red Sox win, the Red Sox win. The boys are cheering. They're the champions. Asher, shouldn't you bring your trophy along to show people today too, right? As Coach Dave said after the game, he said, that's not how we drew it up, but I'll take it. What a great win. And he's right, of course. It most certainly was not plan A to win that way, but you see, plan B, winning through some other means, was still pretty sweet. It was a good win, nonetheless. And I think maybe you can identify with that thought today, that we love our plan A's, of course. We all have our plan A's. We make plans to have things happen, but we also see how plan B quite often is just as good, perhaps. Sometimes better even than the plan A's that we have. Maybe it's the job you work at that wasn't your first pick for your career, your job, but the place you're at now is a pretty great place to work, right? Maybe it's your spouse, not the person you originally set eyes upon in high school, but the one you're married to, they're a pretty great person too. The point I want to make today is that there are all sorts of ways that we develop plans for ourselves, and we see those plans fall through. Our plan A's fall through, right? But our plan B that happens sometimes is just as good, just as sweet. But let's recognize plan B for what it is. Plan B is, well, plan B. It's a backup plan. If plan B was better than plan A, we would have had plan B be plan A in the first place, would we not? Plan B is a backup plan. It's the secondary option for us. All things being the same, Coach Dave would have taken a healthy pitcher to close out his game 10 games out of 10. Plan A is a better option because, well, it's plan A. Why we call it plan A, of course. Now, where I want to go with this today is that students at school, when they hear about creation and God's plan of redemption for the world, they inevitably ask some form of this question here. If the perfect creation of the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve, if that was God's plan, does that mean that Jesus is plan B? Or to put it some other way for us, did God only think of sending his son to save the world? Did he come up with a plan after sin entered the world? Is Jesus the secondary response to God's original plan after creation went off the rails? This question is worthy of wrestling with. This dilemma here, when did God decide to send Jesus into the world to save us from our sins? This question is the heart of our relationship with God. When did God come up with this plan to redeem his people to belong to him? Students ask these questions day after day in classroom. And so I want to ask you this question today too. What do you think? Is Jesus plan B? If we answered yes to the question that Jesus came about after sin entered the world, let's walk through what that would mean for us. First, let me suggest, I think it would mean that God didn't know that we would sin, that sin was somehow outside of his knowing. It would mean that somehow someone or something was opposed to God in a way that he was not able to stop, that there was something beyond his ability to prevent, perhaps. If Jesus is plan B, sin enters the world and God can't do anything about it. So therefore, he comes up with this plan to send his son to the world to redeem us and save us from our sin and defeat evil and so on. But in this view, Jesus is simply the response, the backup, if you will, to God's good plan gone awry. In this view, Jesus wasn't originally supposed to happen because God didn't originally intend to need to save us from our sins. By the way, I got a clicker. I'm missing this thing. I'm sorry for that. Let me move on with this here. Here we go. Now, don't get me wrong. This plan still is a beautiful outcome. The salvation of humanity is a beautiful thing, but let's acknowledge this plan that maybe the deficiencies of it. If Jesus is plan B, it suggests that God is somehow less than all-powerful. He's somehow less than all-knowing, that somehow God is not sovereign over all things. And those are significant pillars of our faith. But what if Jesus then is plan A? What if God always intended for Jesus to save us from our sins? That suggestion has its own set of questions, too. You see, if Jesus was always plan A, then we ask, and students ask, did God create the world knowing that there would be sin? Did God create sin, perhaps? Did God want Adam and Eve to be tempted and fall into sin? Did he make Satan tempt Adam and Eve? Was that whole scene in the garden, was that God's will for that to happen? What was God doing with that? There's more questions we could ask too, I think. How can God be a good and loving God if he knew about sin and suffering and still brought us into the world? What kind of God on purpose creates a world filled with sin and suffering and death and then brings people into it to experience that suffering and death? Doesn't that seem kind of like a mean God, perhaps? Isn't that evil, perhaps? I raise those questions today because I want you to see the logical questions that come about from this question. Is Jesus plan A or is he plan B? Both of those plans have questions that we ask, questions that students bring, questions that perhaps you have been asking in your life. So I want to suggest that these are good questions to ask. Asking, is Jesus plan A or plan B, is a worthy thing for us to explore today. What do you think? Is Jesus God's plan A or is he God's plan B? My son today tried to say both. Told him it's a cop-out answer. You can't say both. And not to belabor this point too much, but I think from our Ephesians text today we see that Jesus most certainly is plan A. As we see in verses 4 and 5 today, we see here that before the foundation of the world, we were chosen to be in Christ. The word here is we were predestined, foreknown, planned to be adopted as sons and daughters of God. And so we see here in this text that Paul lays out for us that Jesus and the whole scope of his redemptive work has always been God's plan since before there was even a creation for us to call home. There was no mistake in creation. There was no lack of knowledge on God's part. There was no, oh, shoot, that was not supposed to happen. How do I fix this? No, there simply is God's unchanging and perfect plan, his immutable will set in place from the beginning of time. With God, there only ever was plan A, so to speak. God doesn't have plan Bs. And so the rest of our time this morning, I want to walk through with you the content of God's plan. What I call his plan, the purpose of his plan, and the promise of his plan. God's plan, God's purpose, and God's promise for us is found in this text for us. So let us look first at God's plan for us and for the world in Jesus Christ. God's plan for us has always been one for unity between God and us. God's design and intent in creating us was for our relationship with God to be so tightly woven that it be as if we are one. Maybe you think of the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus prays for the people, Father, I pray that they may be one even as we are one. Jesus prays for a unity between God the Father and the humanity that he has made. This, of course, was God's intent in creating humanity from the beginning. Adam and Eve walked the garden and they knew the Father. They knew him. They experienced unity with him in a way that no one ever has since. And here in Ephesians, Paul reminds us today of this plan in verse 10 when he writes that God's will is to bring unity to all things in heaven and earth under Jesus Christ. The content of God's plan is to bring unity to all things. In fact, I might suggest to us that the very point of this world existing is for the overflowing oneness of God, his presence, if you will, his spirit, to be more fully expressed with those who bear his image. That God's plan has always been for us to be one with him as he is one with his son. And yet, we recognize God's unity as his plan, his purpose, his motive for operating this world, and yet we see that God knew that his image bearers, you and I here today, would not be able to choose unity with God on his own. God knew that his plan for unity between God above and humans below would need a means, a mechanism, in order to be achieved here. In our humanity, we would never be able to ascend to unity with the divinity of God above. No, you see, the divinity of God above would need to come down to the humanity of this world in order to make us one with God. Jesus, God himself, would need to be the means by which God's intended oneness comes to be expressed in this world. Jesus, therefore, was always God's plan, because it is Jesus who brings all things to unity with God, God above. His life, his death, his resurrection, his ascension into heaven is the means by which we are united to God. They are the means by which we fully know oneness with him. And is this plan centered on Christ that Paul lays out for us today, Ephesians chapter 1? And check out with me here, verse 4. In verse 4, we see it is Jesus who was holy and blameless in our place, who reconciles us to God. In verse 5, we see again, it is Jesus, through him that we are adopted as sons and daughters of God. In verse 7, it is through Jesus and his shed blood that we experience redemption and forgiveness of sins. In verse 8 and 9, it is through Jesus that we understand the mystery of his will. In verse 11, it is in Christ, in Jesus, that we are chosen by God to belong to him. And in verse 13 and 14, let me finish this by saying, it is in Christ that we are marked with the Holy Spirit, the deposit that guarantees our inheritance. And so we see in this text unfolding for us today that God's plan of unity for all things in heaven on above and earth below happens through Jesus Christ and through him alone. It is only through Christ that these things come to pass, because it is only through the Son that these things can come to pass. Let me pause for a moment and suggest it would be good for us to remember that very few of our plans and very few of our schemes work out well for us. Back to Adam and Eve, the very first plan they hatched. Let's see what that fruit tastes like today. Did not work out well for them. Or how about Abraham? Boy, I wonder, that promise of Isaac hasn't come to pass yet. I'll take things into my own hands and I'll take my wife's servant into my own bed. Did that work out well for him? It did not. Or Solomon, you know, worship of God is great and all, but how about these other gods? Maybe if I worship them, God won't mind so much. Did that scheme work out well for Solomon and his heirs? It did not, of course. And maybe you can put yourself in that lens today too. Very few of our plans and our schemes turn out well. And the reality is we all have so many plan Bs today because our plan As are flawed. Our sinfulness, perhaps, is revealed in so many ways in this life because our plans are broken from the start. As I think back in my own life, and maybe think of your own life today too, very little of what we do we say, wow, that course of action I took was the best possible thing. That thing I did was the best possible thing I could have done. And most of the time we look back and say, wow, by the grace of God, he brought me through my sinfulness, my brokenness. As the Heidelberg Catechism reminds us in question answer 8, we are corrupt. We are unable to do any good. We are inclined toward all evil unless we are born of God. Our lives are filled with regret and remorse because the reality is there are many reasons for us to feel that way. Even today, we come to this place and we begin our worship service with a time of confession because we come with the burden of brokenness in life. We see how our lives have not gone as they ought. What we have done is not what God intends for us. But even in the midst of our brokenness, we remember that it is God's plan from the beginning of the world to reconcile humanity, to reconcile you and me to himself. And he does this through Christ alone, because Christ alone is the mechanism by which this can happen. Jesus is the only means by which unity with God above and humanity below can happen. There is no unity if we must ascend to heaven above. No, it must be the good and perfect divine nature of God who comes to this earth, who comes down to the realm of humanity and lifts us up with him. And so it is God's plan today for us to be one with him in Christ, to be united with him so we can be united with God the Father forevermore. Now, this is, of course, well and good and probably some Bible basics for us today. But what's the purpose of all of this? Why is the scheme of redemption and reconciliation being done for? Why does God intend for you and I to be reconciled to God above? That is his plan, to reconcile us, to bring us home with him. But why? Why is that the plan he has set in motion here for? Why is God doing that thing, taking his son and sending him to his world to take sinners like you and I and bring them to him above? Why? Two purposes I want to highlight today for us. The first one is this, the glory of God. I want you to take a look at our text again. Look again at this Ephesians passage. How many times is God's glory mentioned in these opening verses here? Verse 3, God's glory. Verse 5, for the praise of his glory. Verse 12, for God's glory. Verse 14, for his glory. He's all mentioned, of course, the praise of God and his glory. And as I tell my students at school, when you see this repetition in the scripture passage, it is not by chance. Paul repeats himself here not because he likes what he's saying. He repeats himself here because this is crucial to the argument he is putting forth. All that God does in the grand scheme of salvation, all that he does for you and I to bring us, to make us one with him, is for the glory and honor of God. God saves us, he redeems us, he reconciles us in Christ simply because this work shows how awesome and magnificent he is. To take someone like you and me and make us like Christ, to make us spotless and without sin, what an amazing and generous and kind God that is. To unite us to himself and give us the taste of the divine unity, what a gracious and glorious gift that is. And so we see here today that all that God has been doing from the foundation of the world until now has been for the purpose of glorifying himself and exalting his own name. This is not God being selfish. This is simply the correct order of things. There is only one being, one entity who is God Almighty. There is only one being worthy of worship, the Lord and creator of the universe. There is only one being who deserves the adulation and praise of the whole heavenly cosmos. It is the Lord God alone. It is right and proper for us to give him praise and glory because he is the only one who deserves praise and honor and glory in this world. Let me use our marriage as perhaps an example. It is right and is proper for the husband to love his wife alone, and is right and proper for the wife to demand that her husband love her alone, because she is the only one to whom is right and proper to show love and affection, right? It is right and proper. It is the way of things. And just as that is right and proper in our marriages here in this world, so is right and proper in our union with God above to give him glory and honor and praise alone. So the first purpose of why God acts to make us one with him is because it's for his glory, his honor, and his praise. But the second purpose is to bring unity. God acts to bring unity because he desires unity in heaven above and earth below. Now, we know, of course, about this division that we experience. We know that humanity has sinned and has separated ourselves from God. We know there is division between God above and humans below. But I submit to you that God's plan A for the world was created even before the world began. Now, how can there be a need for unity if there is not yet any division between God and humanity? The answer, I think, is found not just in the division here on earth, but it's found also in the division in heaven above. A division that was before we ever were. You see, Ephesians has a distinctly cosmic focus. Ephesians is not focused just on the earthly realms, but on the heavenly realms. We see that phrase here in verse 3, right? Paul says about the God the Father who has blessed us in the heavenly realms. meaning, of course, the realm not where we live, but the realm where spiritual or heavenly beings live. And Paul mentions in chapter 1, verse 20, if you want to look ahead to there, or chapter 6, verse 10, he mentions here the existence of other spiritual beings, what he, of course, calls the rulers, the authorities, the powers, the dominions of this age. And from Paul's words here, we see that these rulers, these authorities, these powers, these dominions are spiritual entities which are opposed to Christ and to God himself. As I read Ephesians, I see Paul's point being developed here that our battle is not just against flesh and blood, but our battle is against the spiritual opponents of us and God. And so we come back to chapter 1, verse 10. We see that God's purpose is not just bringing unity between God above and humans below, but that God's purpose is to bring unity between God and even those spiritual entities that oppose him. Again, chapter 1, verse 10, God's plan to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. That Christ somehow is the one who is Lord over all, and through Christ and because of Christ, there now becomes a unity. There is a unity being pursued in heaven above, those spiritual beings who oppose God, and on earth below, those humans who oppose God too. There is a cosmic focus to the unity, a unity of all things, if you will. All things will one day be united together through Christ, those humans that oppose God, and even those spiritual forces that oppose God. If you have your Bibles open, want to turn with me to chapter 3, verse 10. I want to share a verse with you here too. Here Paul continues developing his argument, and he says in chapter 3, verse 10, his intent, that is God's intent, was that now through the church, those humans of us who belong to God, this church here, the body of Christ, that the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose accomplished through Christ Jesus. That in some way, Christ Jesus coming to bring unity to humanity with God is also his means by which the wisdom of God is on display for the whole cosmic realm. And that through his action for humanity, that there might be in some way an overcoming of the division of heaven itself, that unity is brought not just between heaven and earth, but unity in heaven above is accomplished here too. I imagine, if you will, this division of heaven, these cosmic entities, these powers, these principalities, these rulers, these dominions, seeing Christ come to this earth to redeem this people and saying, I get it. I understand. I now see what this Lord God Almighty is doing. I understand his purpose for the world. And so through Jesus and through his work of salvation, all the cosmos will be united under the authority of Jesus Christ. All evil, all opposition to God, all division in this age and in this space will be done away with forevermore. Because Jesus brings salvation from our sins. Jesus brings union, unity with God. And so today we give praise to God for this gift that we have a union with him. And brothers and sisters, having heard this plan for us, having seen the purpose of God and bringing about this plan, we now hear the promise of God for us today too. You know, when we make plans in this world, we often use the word maybe, possibly, perhaps, right? Maybe we'll do this. Maybe we'll do that. If it works out, right? Very rarely do we make concrete plans of action. My children asked me this past week, can we go to the tropical snow place in Palos Heights? And I said, of course, we'll see, maybe, possibly, right? Until it happens, I don't want to commit to it. The reason for that is we know that things are changing in life. Situations change, people change, plans change. It's difficult to offer ironclad guarantees, isn't it? And when we buy things that might be a guarantee, maybe tools we buy get a guarantee attached to them, it's a 3-year guarantee or a 5-year guarantee, but only if the tool is used correctly, and only if you maintain it correctly, and only if you have the original receipt 3 years afterward. Somebody should develop a system for saving those receipts for us, right? Tracking those things for us. There's a lot of outs, if you will, in our plans that we make, but not so with God. Not so with God. His plans don't have maybes attached to them. His plan is a true guarantee. The Lord God is not going to go back on his word. The Lord God is not going to change his plan. His plan will indeed come to pass. His plan of salvation for us. His plan of redemption through Jesus Christ, our inheritance as the sons and daughters of God, will certainly come to pass. There's no way this plan will be changed. It will most certainly be. And the reason for this certainty is because we are marked with a seal, which is the Holy Spirit. A seal of authenticity, if you will. Back in the ancient world, when a ruler would send a letter to somebody, he would take his ring, his seal, and he would mark the letter in wax. He would seal it with his ring to show that this letter has the authentic word belonging to me. It is not a forgery, not a mistake. This is my authentic word, and you can trust its contents because I have marked this. And so it is with God, that God gives us his seal, the Holy Spirit, if you will, to verify that his promise is true, that his words to us are true, that we actually are his. We have been marked as belonging to God. And so we can be assured that we will belong to God forevermore. Heavenly unity, you see, is guaranteed to be ours. God's plan of salvation will come to pass. And we will experience unity forevermore with God. The reason we can be so certain of this truth is that through the Holy Spirit, even now we have oneness with God. Not complete oneness, mind you, but a foretaste of the reality even now is ours. I find it amazing that God said to us, not just that I want you to one day experience unity with me, not that one day in the future you will know what it is to be one with me. No, even now I give you my Holy Spirit so that you can experience oneness even now. And God in his grace and love for his people says, here and now, I'm going to give you a taste, a little bit, a taste, if you will, of what unity with me will one day be like. He does this in order to remind us of what will one day be ours. You know, maybe you make a cake for a birthday party and your young daughter or son says kind of a taste of the frosting. You say, yes, here you go, here's some frosting. A promise of what that cake will be like. The Holy Spirit is that promise for us. That God's plan A will assuredly come to pass. That one day we will experience the very unity of the triune Godhead himself. The unity of God will be ours. And brothers and sisters, the certain promise today is for all who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation. When you put your hope in Christ, you are marked by his Holy Spirit. And you can be assured that one day, you will have an inheritance of union with God forevermore. And so as we close today, let us give praise to God for this good news. Praise God that he is always intended for our salvation. Praise God that he unites all things in heaven above and earth below through his Son, Jesus Christ. Praise God for the grace and mercy he has shown to us. And praise God that his plan will come to pass. Nothing can oppose it. Nothing can stop it. His plan will come to pass. Praise God indeed. Amen. Let us say a prayer together today too. Father God, I thank you for your word for us, and I thank you that we can give you praise today because of what you intend to do in our lives. Thank you, Father, for the union that you intend for us, the union with you yourself. Lord God, we thank you that you will most assuredly cause this plan to come to pass. Thank you, Father, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who enacts this plan, and thank you for your Holy Spirit, which reminds us of this plan. And Father, may we leave today remembering and being assured that your plan for unity is for each and every one of us. Be with us today in Jesus' name. Amen.
We are certainly assured that Jesus is ours, so let us stand and sing our song of response this morning, Blessed Assurance. Announcements in the bulletin to kind of pay attention to. There are a couple showers coming up, a couple baby showers, which is very exciting. There's also a need for a custodian, hoping to start this fall. And there was also a prayer email sent out on Wednesday about the arrest of a retired Christian Reformed pastor in relation to 1975 murder. So we will certainly be praying for that situation today. Again, the information is in the prayer email. So let us come before our God in a time of prayer this morning. Almighty and loving God, you created the world in its beauty. You set the stars in the sky and caused plants to grow on the earth. You created animals and humans alike. All creation sings your glory. You have gathered us here together today and have taught us and challenged us by your word. We give you thanks for so many things. We thank you for the resources of the earth, rain that waters the plants, sun that encourages their growth, and the sustenance that they provide to the people on earth. We thank you for opportunities to celebrate things like marriage and new life, both within our church family and on a national and global level. We also thank you for renewed life and reunion, as with the safe return of Alicia Navarro, the teen from Arizona who had been missing for 4 years. That joyous reunion is only a fraction of the joy that we will experience when we are reunited with you. You are also the God of compassion and the Lord of providence, So we not only come before you to give thanks, but to ask for your hand to move in this world. We think of the ongoing war in the Ukraine and unrest that is happening in Niger. We continue to pray for peace and healing in these situations, and we ask for protection for those who are in immediate danger. And we pray for the leaders involved in these conflicts, and that you might bless them with wisdom. While we see and give thanks for the good things of creation, we also know that it can be dangerous. We think of record-breaking heat that is sweeping across the country and even parts of the world. We pray for those who do not have the resources to protect themselves in this heat, and we pray that we might find ways to share your blessings with them. And today, we also lift up David Sandstra and the family of Gretchen Harrington. We pray for wounds that have been reopened and for the shock and pain being felt on all sides. We ask that your comfort and strength surround those that are involved and those that are affected by this heartbreaking news. We also pray that in coming days, grief may be channeled into meaningful action and that steps may be taken, especially in our church communities, to prevent harm to your beloved children, both young and old. You have called us to give thanks and also to bring our worries and our burdens to you. Hear our prayers, O Lord, in the name of your Son and through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our offering this morning is for the Elam Hope Packs, which you can leave in the baskets on your way out. And I'd like to invite you to stand for our final blessing.
People of God, receive the blessing of God for you. May the grace of the Father, the love of the Son, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and the week to come. Amen.